So thank you for the very, very nice introduction, Ragnhild. I think you are at the brink of becoming an economist because your presentation was so interesting that I wanted to hear more about Norway. So this is a very nice occasion for me to be talking to you. And the topic of the conference is of high relevance. Norway is, as Ragnhild said, small, icy, far up in the north. But we are very used to being through transitions. So the topic of this course, which is change is the new normal, is really Norway. Norway is change is the new normal, because we have been through, we used to be shipbuilders, or before that we were really poor farmers, then we were shipbuilders, then we have the oil and gas decades, and now we have to rethink our new normal. And I'm going to talk about, I'm going to give you an introduction to Norway, not because, again, Norway is the most interesting place in the world, but because we have been through changes. We know what we are talking about. And then I'm going to relate to some of the key questions of today, and which is also the key questions of this conference, namely, how do we adapt to the new normal of the digitalized, the technological intense machine learning, the second machine age, basically. How do we adapt to that, and how should we, as a business school and executive education, how should we think about that? So let me then start with some background. So Norway is among, we used to be among the 10 top producers of oil and gas. We are now ranked number 14, so we have Norway there. But we are among the main producers of oil and gas, and the reason we are a bit down now is because the US has come to the top with the shale boom, and Canada has also increased a lot with the shale boom. Why I'm introducing this graph is not necessarily to show that we are a major producer, but it's to show you that we are among a group of countries which not necessarily are the one we compare us with when we want to talk about Norway's performance. So like Russia, China, Iraq, Iran, Kuwait, Venezuela, and a lot of these countries. These countries are typically not our peers in terms of economic performance, at least. So, and as an economist, when I started to work with, I'm a broad macroeconomist, but when I started to work with the questions related to oil and gas, or petroleum, or resources, I quickly went to look at the literature to find out what should we know about the development in resource-rich countries, because that's basically what we are thinking about. The resource-rich country, what should we expect for that country? Because there's a paradox, as Ragnhild said, in the sense that Norway is very resource-rich, but if you look at these countries, they don't rank, at least many of these countries, they don't rank happiness and welfare and richness at their top. So if you look at the literature, there is a negative relationship, basically, between countries being resource-rich and their economic performance. So this graph just shows you a snapshot of countries, and it shows you a line between the growth in the countries after 1960 and how large resource export of GDP. So if you think of Norway, at some point I think we had 30-40%. We should really have an almost zero or negative relationship between growth and our resource intensity. And there's a huge literature, which I'm not going to go into detail, of course, which asks this question, is having resources a blessing or a curse? And the answer has typically been, when you look at this in cross-section, it is a curse. And that's why you have resource curse as a huge literature. And you also have something called Dutch disease, which basically is a milder variant. You're not cursed, but you're diseased. so you basically end up, some of your industries, like manufacturing, typically are crowded out. So when I live in this country, and when I do work as an economist, that I don't recognize that for Norway. So that's why we started to do research, and I've been doing research now for 8 years on these topics. And when we started to do the research, it turned out a lot of economists in Norway and people on the street and general people interested in Norway, they didn't think oil and gas mattered for our social welfare. But still, we didn't have the curse. So somehow we managed to extract and we managed to find and extract all these resources. But it didn't do anything for us, according to popular press. And it didn't give us the curse. So what did it do? That's basically what I wanted to talk about. So here, let's look at some facts. So Norway turns out to, in the 60s, 70s, Norway were one of the poorest countries in Europe. We came from being one of the poorest countries to being one of the richest countries. So this shows GDP per capita, so the measure of income in the country in real terms, compared to, for instance, Sweden, that black line, UK or New Zealand. And as you can see, Norway is not only leading the way, but they have really been leading the way. So GDP growth per capita in Norway has been fantastic relative to the other countries. That is clearly due to oil and gas. When oil and gas is valued a lot, it means that the GDP per capita is also has a lot of value. And because we are only 5 million people here, GDP per capita is going to be quite high. So if I put Luxembourg here, Luxembourg would have been among, we could be comparable, but Luxembourg has a small population, but they have another industry. So, but still, that doesn't answer my question. What's the role of oil and gas in the sense of driving growth in the economy? I know that we are rich. GDP per capita, the measure of income for individual, is high relative to other countries. Okay, so to be able to answer specifically a question why or what's the role of oil and gas, we have to get one thing on the table immediately. Where did the wealth from the under the ground go? And if I ask the people abroad, and if you have a glimpse at the program, you will see that there is something called the oil fund in Norway. And there's somebody coming to talk about that tomorrow or the day after tomorrow, I think, Friday. So we did something remarkably, and now I'm giving you all the remarkable and the fantastic thing. There will be negative things going along, so don't think that this is only a bragging speech. But we did something remarkable. So the first thing we should note for one of the reasons behind our success, or one of the reasons for why we didn't have the curse, is the fact that we decided not to spend it all immediately. Because there was a lot of oil under the ground. As you saw from the first slide, we were a major producer. And this oil we invested in the government pension fund. And the government pension fund is today the largest sovereign wealth fund in the world. It invests in 9,000 companies in 78 different countries. And this slide is probably not updated anymore. It probably invests in more companies, etc. So that is a government-owned fund, invest abroad. But then you would think, what did the government itself do with the money in Norway? Because clearly it's not just want to invest abroad and don't want to use anything. Well, then they managed to do something quite remarkable. The bureaucrats in the Ministry of Finance managed to convince the politicians that they should only use 3 or 4% of that wealth each year, the real return on that wealth. So that is the spending room. Spend 3, 4%, it used to be 4, now it's 3, that's why I write 3 to 4. Spend 3 or 4% of the wealth each year in the budget. Which meant, when the fund was quite large, so this is like 1,000 billion US dollar. You get 3% of that in a small country is sizable after all. So there eventually became a lot of money coming in that way. So then the answer to my question, why are we so happy and why are we so growth so high? It could be just due to this. The government is spending a lot of money in the Norwegian economy. And I think that was one of the perception out there, that we are just happy and we have a good social welfare system, etc. But our research shows that there's something more. Our research shows there's something with technology, which I will get to now. So now I'm going to show you a couple of slides which are research-based, and I'll explain to you. You don't have to go into nitty-gritty details at all. It just basically tells you the following. There has been huge spillover from the extraction of oil and gas to other industries. And why is that the case? So first of all, these are typical graphs economists look at when they want to show what's the direct effect of oil and gas, not just looking at graph and saying we are rich and we are happy. This is a huge model which shows you the effect of extraction of oil and gas to GDP, again, the measure we had looked at, to productivity, which is GDP in terms of how many workers you have, and employment. And we, in some of our studies, we compare to other research-rich countries. Here we compare to Australia. They don't have oil and gas, but they have iron ore and gas and a lot of other stuff. So basically we show after you find oil, you extract it, then there is going to be a boom in the economy. So these things, this solid line is the response for Norway. The dotted line is the response for Australia. Don't care about the shadows. The shadows is just telling me about significance, and you want them to be above the zero. So this is just telling you, after you find oil and gas, there's going to be spillover, or the GDP, and by the way, this is mainland economy, not including oil anymore. So now this is mainland economy. I should have written that. So GDP in mainland economy increases. Eventually the effect dies out, but it dies out, this is quarter, it dies out after 5 years. For each time you extract a new 1%, that's going to happen to GDP in the mainland. So this is 1% increase in petroleum activities, and that affects the mainland economy in Norway, and also in Australia for a different resource boom, GDP in Australia also increases. Productivity, that's amazing, it increases in the mainland economy when you extract oil and gas, and employment increases. So basically you have aggregate effects, positive aggregate effects, no resource curse in Norway from the direct effect of oil and gas. So here I address it directly, not in the cross section, I address it directly by looking at the effect of oil and gas extraction, investment on the mainland economy. But still you're not convinced. Still you think, oh, this is just due to the big government sector, the oil fund. It's not really adding any, I mean, this doesn't tell us anything about engineers or business people or construction people. This just tells us that the government took the money and spent it. And these are government employment, you think. But that's not the case. If you look at the disaggregate, and that's the third fact kind of thing, here are the effect on the industries of Norway. Oh, it's equally sized shock, we call it shock, in the resource sector. So again, I extract, invest, think, produce, 1% increase in the activity in the petroleum sector. So 1% increase in activity in the oil and gas. New field, more productive field, or more investment. What is the effect on the industries? No, not in the oil, but in construction, business, hotel and food, retail, transportation, non-resource transportation, financial, manufacturing, scientific production, real estate, and public sector. What's the effect of increased activity, real effect? These are all positive. That's why they are to the right. These are positive numbers. And these are value added. So this is production. And black means they're significant. All increase in Norway. So there's a huge spillover to technological intense industry. Manufacturing, which should really go down the drain, if I could be so blunt. In an oil-producing economy, manufacturing shouldn't be able to survive because the currency appreciates and it extracts resources. Manufacturing has boomed in Norway. And how come? Well, employment has also boomed in Norway. In all industries have had this positive spillover. And the reason is, and we write about that in several papers, the reason is that to extract resources 100 meters under the ground, under the sea level, in harsh climate, requires technology, it requires skills, it requires learning by doing, and it requires interaction by other industries and other service industries. So both production and service industries are involved in this process. And here's another thing the Norwegian government did in the 70s, which they can't do today. They said, everything we extract, all the people working there should be from Norwegian companies. So we are going to shelter the mainland industry so they can develop this knowledge. And we are going to recruit international experts, Americans, Shell and others, into Norway, and they're going to train the Norwegians. So each thing you extract has to have a Norwegian company and international expert, and then you're going to learn. You're going to learn from being shipbuilders, learning, to becoming producer yourself. So when we developed our resources, we didn't do it on our own, but we did it with our own people and we learned from the experts. We managed to learn from the expert. So eventually, when we could no longer shelter our industries, when we had to open up for competition due to EU regulations, we were competitive. We were competitive not because prices were low or because we didn't pay enough, etc., but because we had the expert and the knowledge and the technology. And we have learned it from the Americans. So we have this, in the 80s, we had this fire in one of the platforms, and we needed to close that fire. It was a dramatic time. And we then couldn't do it on ourselves because we didn't have the knowledge. So we got the Americans, this cowboy ready there or something, who came in. And he with cowboy boots from Texas, of course, and he managed to turn out the fire. We didn't have the experts. Now, a few years ago, you saw there was, if you follow American news, there was a fire in the Mexican Gulf. They weren't able to turn out the fire. Do you know who turned out the fire? Of course, some Norwegians. So now we had the expert. Now we could go and do that. And that's not just expert in terms of having oil producers who do mechanical work. It's the technological experts. Because the thing with oil, there's not many people working on the platforms. Or if you've been to the shale producers in North America, there's not many people working there. But there's a lot of experts behind it. So that's the reason behind the success. And that's one of the things which we discovered and which we produced in our article. And this was fine. So we have managed to explain that some of the success behind this happiness and the wealth was because we have managed to extract. We had evolved a lot of industries. And we also had built up a sovereign wealth fund, which gave something back to the people in terms of social goods, in terms of education for everybody, etc. So we had good institution and good democracy. So everything was doing well, except the following. Then the sign turned. So first it turned a little bit during the financial crisis. Oil prices dropped. But then, after a very short time, oil prices went back again, so no problem for Norway. But then in 2014, they really dropped, 70%. And that, of course, is not something which you just, I don't know what is in English, you don't, yeah, snap up. Because that is going to affect Norway when you have, although you have, although I'm giving you sort of like the I'm giving you the idea here that we have a spillover to a lot of industry. It's good when you're in a boom, but it's not necessarily good when you are in a recession, of course, because it means that other industry will also go down the drain. So that's why something I talked a lot about. That's why I've been in the press a few years back, because there has been people in Norway, they weren't prepared for these kind of spillovers and how it would affect the Norwegian economy. So when the signs turned, there was a lot of international focus, but we were taken a bit by surprise in Norway. Except also did the research, who knew it. Economists had an article in 2013 looking at the Nordic welfare system, where Norway was basically described as just a rich cousin in the north. Finland has schooling, Sweden has small industry and even some tech societies, but Norway was just a rich cousin in the north. If you are a rich cousin in the north and whatever you are selling, the price of that drops, well, that's what the economists thought in 2015 is going to happen to Norway. It's going to be a catastrophe. And for many of the countries you saw on the first slide, Russia, Venezuela, it was a catastrophe in the sense that GDP really dropped, unemployment increased by a lot, and the currency depreciated. That happened also in Norway, but not to that extent. It happened in Norway because we had these spillovers, we were exposed. So unemployment increased a lot in Norway. And this compares unemployment increase in percentage times in Norway. The black is how much it increased during this oil down in 2014 for each month after it started to increase. And I compare it here to the financial crisis in Norway. So it just shows you from the start of the financial crisis, each month is the red, from the start of the oil downturn, and each month is the black. And you see in Norway, unemployment increased by more in the oil downturn than during the financial crisis. But now it's back a bit. Financial crisis was a bit more persistent, but it increased by more. And one of the reasons it increased by more, of course, is the spillover. But one of the reasons it went down and why we didn't go up the drain is because we had a sovereign welfare. And the other countries didn't have that. So we could have contractive policies. We could increase public spending. We could increase social welfare. And we could do all these kind of activity measures which a lot of these oil producing countries couldn't do. So that's why, yes, we had effect, but we didn't have such a severe effect as the other countries. But that's why it's today, I think, 20% cheaper for you to come here, if you have a dollar at least, relative to 2014, but not 40% cheaper as it is in Russia or Venezuela, where the currency are really depreciated, if you come with your dollars. Or if you come with your euro, it's around 10% cheaper. Okay, so we managed to stand through the oil downturn. We did have the effects, but we managed to stand through it. So what now? So clearly something which has happened during this, which is a bit challenging during these transitions, is that we have had people who have become unemployed, which didn't find work. And there Norway has challenges which will be, have to be dealt with going forward. So here's one of those challenges. Norway has a lot of people working, but we have also a sizable share of the population on social on disability benefit. So basically, when you don't find work, we have the means to support you through social disability benefit. So Norway rank high and higher than the other Nordic countries in having people outside working, outside the workforce. And this is a major problem, of course, because if you go through transitions, as an economist, it's better to have people unemployed than to have them on disability benefit. Because if they're not working, it's hard to have them to do changes to the economy. And there's a lot of research, which I'm not involved in, but which others both in Norway and Sweden are doing, which shows that a lot of this disability benefit is not explained by economic, or sorry, is not explained by illness and disease, is explained by social conditions or economic condition. So one social condition is that if a lot of people are on disability benefit in a small community, it's a higher probability that other people in that community will be on this kind of benefit. And this is a huge problem in a small open economy because it's going to be very costly going forward, and that is something the government has to deal with in terms of trying to find better reforms to get people back to the country, to the workforce. So in this transition period, a lot of people have been asking, what should we do now? What should we do going forward? What should be our after oil kind of success stories? And when journalists and others call me, they say, what should we live of after oil? So first I have to tell them, well, it's not after oil yet. You saw on the first slide, we still have some oil and gas. It's still providing some income. But still, what should be our major industry? What should be the thing we should be doing now? And in the years after, at least after 2014, there has been a lot of, let me put it this way, funny suggestions of what people think we should live of after Norway. A lot of these suggestions has nothing to do with what we know. It has nothing to do with the kind of industry we've had. It has basically been that we should live of our nature, we should live of ourselves, etc. So I asked the following question. What is our made in Norway kind of thing? What is our brand? And Professor Silke says she's an expert in marketing, so she knows about branding. That's the thing you need to know. So what is our made in Norway after the oil downturn? That's what people want to know. What do we have left now that is unique? What can we live of afterwards? What is our made in Norway? And when you ask yourself that question, and you are from different nationalities, when you ask yourself that question, what is your made in Norway? Made in Spain, made in whatever. What is your sort of like main brand? So I Googled, and first I know made in Italy. Are there somebody from Italy here? Yeah. So I did it made in Italy first, because that is well known. So, and I have all of this, of course. The Ferrari, the Versace glasses, and the haute couture there. Well, not as haute couture. But still, these are the kind of Armani, Versace kind of thing. That is the made in Italy. Because they have decades, a century, I think, with tailors and expertise, generations passing on to new generation of their handicraft. And their expertise, and we know that if you get these things, these are quality. So then I googled of course made in Norway, and when I google made in Norway, I get to this. very disappointing, in particular if I go back to that. Doesn't look at all that expensive. Doesn't look like something we can live with after oil and gas. Definitely not. But still, that is indirectly what people thought we should be living off after oil and gas, because what they suggested, what we should use our traditions. We should live off our traditions. And if you Google that, they have this is a Norwegian national, this is part of the national costume. We have it more expensive and more fancy than that, but this is like the national costume. But this particular national costume is taken from when we were the poorest. So this is back like 100 years ago. That's the poorest national costume for the common people. Something called Norwegian Husflid, which has, they're making those, they have made that into their brands. If you Google made in Norway, you get to them. And a lot of blogs about knitting and stuff like that. But if you ask yourself what is made in Norway, if you think about my talk so far, I haven't talked about that. What I have talked about is knowledge and technology. And that is our made in Norway. Our made in Norway is basically what we have been doing so far and what we have been doing very well. We have knowledge and we have technology. So be it that we use it for oil and gas is no longer popular, it's all about the green economy. But we have knowledge and technology of extracting resources. And we still have something left, but not enough for us to be dependent on that going forward. So now change is a new normal, has to be initiated. So we have to use it in a new, new way. And as I emphasized to you, one of the reasons we had the success relative to maybe some of the other oil producing countries is that we discovered and extracted raw materials which demanded technical competence. And that was good luck for us. It was good luck it was under the sea and not just lying there easily available in Bay of Nydalen. Because we needed all the engineers and we need all the consultancy and we need all the executive training because we needed people to learn. And we needed the international expert. We needed international community. So we managed to transform resources into technology and competence. And we had this knowledge transfer to the other part of society. So innovation in Norway beyond oil and gas is not going to be something else. It's going to be knowledge and technology, but used in other areas. It's going to be used in sea windmills. It's going to be used in offshore fish farming, because we still have the resources, other resources. It's going to be used in health equipment, and I'll give you an example in a second. Simulators, in consultancy, because we are expert consultancy all over the world now, with economics, with petroleum engineering, etc., with how to set up a sovereign wealth fund. So we are going to take this platform, and we are already doing that, and extract, which extract oil and gas, and now use it, you see the similarity, in this sea merd, which is basically offshore fish farming, which has the advantage that they don't get so polluted when you do it inside the rivers. So we are doing sea farming outside in the sea, using this technology, sea windmill, still not 100% profitable, but will be, I think, going forward with all the winds coming and blowing in the North Sea. The machinery here is the kind of machinery you have there. And what's interesting is that in other industry, not related at all to resources, like health industry, we are using the same technique to develop new equipment. So when you have oil going through pipes under the sea, you have to measure the pressure. So when you are operating a heart patient, you have to measure the pressure in the bloodstream. So that equipment is now used in mass scale in the hospitals, and they are used to surveil people who are operated. So health industry is taking advantage of the technology there. So another reason why we didn't have such a huge recession in the oil recession is that we could the engineers got work other places, in the public sector, in the health industry, in the green industry, in the fish industry, and as teacher, and other stuff. And one issue we have, which is a small of a paradox, is that still we don't have enough engineers. Because although our share of students majoring in science is quite low relative to, for instance, Sweden or other research-rich countries. Still, we have to look at the scale here. It's 1% relative to 1.5%. But still, it's a paradox that Norway is there. And that is one of the paradoxes in the sense or maybe it's not the paradox is the right word here, but that is one of maybe one of the curses we had, that we allowed people to study whatever they liked in the album. And they are, I have a daughter, she's a drama queen, I call her. She thought she could study whatever, now she's 17. Now she, I tell her, you have to study to be an engineer. Or you have to do business, and then you have to do an executive, of course. something like that. But we had too many people studying whatever they liked. So a lot of those who did PhD in Norway in engineering and others, they were international coming to Norway. So we need to get more people to study engineering. And we need to be, and I'm getting now to the executive part, we need also executive training for business leaders who want to be leaders of engineers. And that's why this is an interesting challenge. But this is just to tell you that there has been some challenges, and it relates to your question also. It wasn't a problem to get the Norwegians to go to those positions, because there were not that many. And they, but the international were happy to come and move in, so we get to attract internationals. So we are a small country, and we wouldn't be able at all to extract this without the international moving here and giving us advice. So what now? So the future going forward, so we are hit by, I think, at least two issues, which or two waves, we could put it. One, we have the oil recession and the transition, at least partly out of oil and gas and into new industry. And the other is that the future is knowledge and technology. So the future is not muscle, it's brain, and I will also say it, probably the heart. Because going forward, routine and repetitive jobs will automate it. We know that, you can read it every day. And I know it's a topic on this conference. So manufacturing, accounting, and also health, a lot of this work will be automated. Soon you can go to machine and it can tell you what kind of disease you have with the eye, or I think you can do it already. So you don't need that many people to read it. The question is, do the workers today have that skills? That you have to ask yourself in all countries. Do you have the skills to go through that transition? Will they be able to find good jobs in the age of digitalization and robotization, which some economists call, or IT people call, the second machine age? Will they be able to find work if they don't have that skill, or with the skill they have? And with the kind of computers and the kind of techniques we have today, you can read tons of data. You can have a computer program who can read data of health, about health, about production, etc. From PDF. You can have computer programs who can read that for you, so you can construct a lot of data, or you can find a lot of data, or you can have a lot of data. So in all businesses, a successful business need to develop a plan using a lot of data. And to have for production, for customers, for marketing, etc. All that data is available there. So you need to learn coding skills, and you need to work with large amounts of data. These are the kind of skills you need. And these are the kind of transition you have. And Norway had the good luck in the sense that we have knowledge and technology. We do have that. We just have to put it in the right places going forward. And we need more people to study it. Even though we succeeded, we still need more. Okay, so we need to learn more of that. And we know the most popular studies now is to learn coding and technology. So it's like, just listen to the young people, what they want to do. They want to learn machine learning, they want to learn coding, etc. They don't want to sit with their pen and pencil and write essays anymore. So that's why, as a business school also, you need to educate people to lead those kind of people. So for so the executive is now at a new crossroad, and I'm just teaching on the executive. I don't have anything to do with the executive development program, but I think the executive will see whatever they will see the same as the rest of the society is seeing, namely that we are in a digital society, and I know you know it from the program. Teaching and memorizing facts is irrelevant today. You don't need to. I mean, you see it in the school already that students don't memorize as much. And as executive and as leader of businesses, this kind of skill is not what we need to memorize stuff. We have the computers for that. The doctors, they can put in the symptoms and out come a diagnosis. So teaching and memorizing facts is irrelevant. But be able to learn, to analyze, to think critically and make an argument, that is what matters. And that is a challenge also for, that is a challenge for the education system, for the businesses, for the executive and for the government. They all need to talk together to be able to develop the kind of workforce which has these kind of skills. So we have the knowledge and technology, we have the brain, but now we also need to take it further. And that's why I said to the heart, but what I mean is that we need to take it further into the communication. So to be able to talk, to be able to have these skills, to work with teams and across discipline will be important going forward. At least that's what I think is important going forward. And I think from reading what the computer are going to do in the future and what IT technology is going to be able to do, this is what is going to be a skill which we need to develop going forward, the communication across discipline. But this was basically the last thing I wanted to say, and I see there's many hands. I don't know whether... So let me just finish with, there's no time to rest. Change is the new normal, your slogan for the...